Hey, Coach, I'm so excited that you found us on YouTube. I've been coaching for 30 years, put a lot of videos up there for you to use. I hope you're enjoying them. Let me know how I can help you in this great journey. Coach, this guy, he's pretty good. I think he's playing for the Bucks this year. But let me help you. You know, I've been through it. I've won a lot of championships. You can see behind, run one of the best high school programs in the country. I can help. I've been there. I've coached my son's team, the youth teams. Let me help you through this great journey. TeachHoops.com is the answer. One-on-one calls, office hours, resources, you name it. We got it. We can help you. I have been there. So let me help you through this journey. So go over and check it out. Enjoy the video. Two,
one. All right. Welcome to Coach Unplugged. I have Coach Moore on today. So Coach, you're a Midwest guy, right?
Absolutely, I am.
You are. So I'm going to let you introduce yourself, and then we have a couple connections I saw when you sent me your stuff. So why don't you just introduce yourself, tell the listeners about you, about kind of your history, and then we'll dive in from there.
All right. I'm originally from Hammond, Indiana, Larry Moore Jr. I'm the head coach at Hammond High School. Went to K through 8 in Hammond, went to high school at St. Francis de Sales, played for my father. I come from a long line of coaches. My brother's coach. Both of my parents coached. That is my pedigree as a coach and as a player. I've been involved in the game of basketball since third grade. So,
how did you like – so my son's a senior. So he's one of these seniors that is going through this horrible time right now. But how was it playing for your dad? And what were the pluses and minuses with that?
The pluses was I was always got time to spend time with my dad. Got to be in the gym unlimited.
Yeah.
However, as a son of a coach, you deal with a lot of dynamics in terms of classmates, teammates, and opponents thinking that you're only on the team because your dad. So you have a lot to prove as a son. But I wouldn't trade it for the world. We have a great relationship to this day. He's still my mentor, and he's actually the athletic director at the school that I coach at. So I get an opportunity to not only play for my dad, I get to work with him every day. So that's a blessing.
Yeah, I tell people, well, first of all, I tell parenting is like the best roller coaster you're ever going to go on. But it was the same coaching. It was the best and the worst of times, if I can quote Dickens, I think, a little bit. That it was great. I wouldn't trade it for anything. But it's a hard – people don't realize how hard a dynamic it is.
Right.
If you're the best player or you're the worst player, I think those are the only two really good spots to be if you're anywhere in between.
And I was the best player my junior and senior year, so it took it as, you know, I was that because of my dad. I mean, he put me in a position, but I still had to perform. And
Right. And you're getting more shots because you're the coaches, all that kind of stuff. Right. I know. So yeah. Tell me about your basketball playing career. I see you played for Coach Pearl. I met Coach Pearl flipping burgers at Milwaukee. So he got the Milwaukee job and we were down there. This was when Wesley Matthews was coming through and he was flipping he had just come from whatever that D2 school was.
He was at Southern Indiana.
He was at Southern Indiana and then he took the Milwaukee job, and the first time I met him, we were there playing in the Milwaukee Summer League and he's out there flipping burgers. I go, wow, this guy's a workhorse, man. He's flipping burgers.
So out of high school I signed at Eastern Illinois, played a year there. Things didn't really work out. So I transferred into Southern Indiana right after they won the national championship. Played three games of open gym to 10. Coach Pearl offered me a scholarship after three games. Went on to play for him. Coach Pearl, dynamic man. He is a player's coach. He has a passion for the game. He loves his players. He'll go through a brick wall for you, as sometimes coaches want you to do that. So it's vice versa. So I enjoy playing for him. Just the energy that he has on TV is the energy that he has at practice at 7 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday. Is no change of energy.
No, it's like a lot of those guys have. First of all, I think that level of coaching has changed so much that it's almost become like I'm being, you know, like a politician. You got to be so good on TV.
Absolutely.
I don't know if the Majerus was pretty funny though, but yes, he's like, yeah, he's always, all these guys have, so everyone I've met at that level, something, they have so much energy and they're always like, Energizer bunnies. It's crazy. I
know Coach Pearl spends a lot of hours coaching. He loves his faith. He's at Mass every Sunday, and after Mass, he's back to basketball and his family. So, you know, and it's carried over. He's been successful at every level. So I wasn't surprised when he got Auburn to the Final Four.
No, I mean, it's here. My theory in this, I've said this a million times. My theory is if you can coach a third grade girls team or an eighth grade boys team, you can coach in the Final Four. It's very similar. The game is pretty similar. Awesome. All right. So let me jump in and ask a few questions here. So let's talk practice, because that's been on my mind a lot recently. Okay. So talk about three things that you think are important for practice, or some golden nugget that you can share with our audience in terms of practices.
So as a young head coach 8 years ago, I tried to incorporate everything, and I wasn't very successful. So probably in the year 3-4, I started talking to my coaches about we need to focus on three things and be great at that. And so number one was changing the mentality defensively. So we started practice what we call a pregame, and it's a bunch of defensive drills where we're working on closeouts, being on balance, jumping to the ball, a lot of talking.
I think it's like how I set my tone in my classroom or how I set it at practice. It's mm-hmm. those first two or three drills. It's those first two or three things that if any coach is listening to this, young coach, you set the tone early. Like how practice is going to go is those early drills, and defensively is a great idea.
Yeah, we start off with defense, and the kids know they have to be mentally ready for that first 15 minutes of practice because we're really stressing. Communication, right. Jumping to the ball, and it's the same routine. Now, the back end of my practice may switch up, but that first 15 minutes is pretty much set of what we're going to do. Even the day before a game, I still want them locked in mentally because it sets the tone.
Right. Is there anything that you think, like a young coach is listening to this practice-wise, that other than like what I kind of said there with setting the tone, you're basically talking about simplifying. You're trying to simplify.
One thing that I think I didn't do a great job at as a younger coach, just because a kid is 16 to 17 years old, you think they should be skilled or have the fundamentals or the terminology together. So you have to coach them for the level that you have. And sometimes you have to dummy things down. And, you know, we know in math you can't do
multiplication. You can't do calculus before you can add. Yes.
Absolutely. And so that's one thing that I think I've gotten a lot better at over the years, of focusing on the small details leading up into, because if you can play man to man, you can put any zone defense in place, but it has to be the foundation of man to man. So my freshman team is not allowed to play any zone. It's man to man. You can trap, but it's building that foundation. So as they get to JV and varsity, that we're able to go more in depth in terms of.
Yeah. Sports. I've told people that it should be illegal for like middle school and elementary school kids to play anything, but man, it should be like against the law. It should be like the social distancing laws that we're all dealing with. It's like, yeah, it should be the opposite of that. Like you have to play man to man. Cause I go to some of these tournaments and they're playing 2-3 zone when they're like 10 years old. What are you doing? Like no one ever remembers that Saturday in January when they,
nobody at all. And people are trying to win. And that's kind of the pros and cons of that summer basketball, but we try to stay on top of them. My middle school is running our man-to-man and our different things. So that's been very important.
So dive into that. That's a good side note. Dive into that. Tell me a little bit about your youth program and how that kind of works in your system.
So in Indiana, we're 6-8. And so over the past few years, my middle school coaches have done a great job of communicating with me and my staff in terms of what is it that they want us to teach? What do we want them to learn? Terminology, different things of that nature. So they are pretty much.
Is it one middle school?
Yes, that feeds into mines. However, we have four middle schools in our in Hammond. We have four public high schools.
Okay, so you have one middle school and like probably three or four elementaries that feed into that middle. So you have one. So you know where those kids are coming. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. But we're on the border of Indiana, Illinois, so there's a lot of movement that takes place with people moving across the border back and forth. So, but for the most place, our students are coming from Eggers Middle School.
Okay. And that, then, and I would say that's an important. And then, do you have anything for the little ones, like the K through five?
Over the past few years, I've had a couple of guys step up, do really well, and building our elementary level. And I think it's very important because we were at a place where they were practicing maybe 30 minutes a week. Anybody was coaching them. It was just kind of whoever was in the building. But over the past few years, that's gotten a lot better, which has led to the success of us winning 3 sectional championships in a row.
Right.
We went 20-4 last year. We were stopped, obviously, because of this pandemic, unfortunately.
Right. I know. But,
It's been really good having that network all the way down. It's really helped our program.
So tell me about what would your coaching philosophy be? If you had if someone came in and watched your practice or talked to you, what would they take away?
My teams are known for being the toughest team on the court. Regardless of talent, we're going to play hard every possession. We're going to guard. We're going to get up. We're going to put pressure on you offensively and defensively. So guys that coach against me, they know that you're going to be in for a battle every time you play us. And again, it doesn't always go our way. That's the way basketball is, but I preach every day, we're going to be the toughest team on the floor, period. It doesn't matter who we're facing.
Right. So let's go in a time machine. And so let's say you could go back to yourself when you got this job you're in right now. Mm-hmm. What would you tell yourself if you could go back there right after you got the job? What would be your advice to your younger you is the question.
Focus in on skill work. Focus in on not so many different things. Find 3 things, focus in on. And for me, it's been defense, it's been ball handling, and it's been passing. So once we became better and I went back to basic chest passes, down the court, bounce passes, I went back elementary, and we do those to this day.
Right.
We became a better, fundamentally sound team. I didn't do it as much when I first came in, but as I was into about year 3 or 4, I scaled back and went back and made those corrections that I didn't do.
I think what's hard for coaches is there's so much noise out there. Like, oh God, look what Bennett's doing in Virginia. Look what Coach K is doing. And everyone, it's like, Here's what I tell young coaches: find something that you believe in, that you think will work, and then run with that. You can't be everything to everyone, to be honest.
And I'm to agree with you on that. However, they do a great job, all of them, but they have the personnel every year to plug into that.
Right.
My philosophy 1 year may be different the next year simply because of personnel.
Right.
Not able to plug in a shooter every year, you know. Yeah. You make guys that get to the basket.
It's kind of like, I tell people, it's kind of like making soup. You know, you just got to figure out sometimes you put a few extra onions in, sometimes you put some extra. It just depends on who's coming up that pipeline in your school.
You're right.
You know, we would all like to run, a Kentucky type team, but you know, you don't necessarily have that talent every year. Yeah.
Absolutely.
What do you think the hardest thing to teach is?
The hardest thing to teach is, at this point, being a teammate.
Interesting. Okay. So dive into that deeper. You're the first person to say that to me in probably a year.
Myself as a player, for instance, my older brother and my younger brother both played downstate. Okay.
Okay.
On the flip side, I made All-State 2 years in Illinois. I would take going downstate and playing on that stage as opposed to being an All-Stater because winning matters to me.
Yeah.
Okay. And so
what I tell my players is, mom can't go and buy you. Like, we've got 3 state tournaments. So I wear the rings and stuff once in a while. And I go that mom can't go to Target and buy you one of these, you know?
Absolutely not. And so we're in a generation of basketball where everything is about me, and it comes from so many different factors, and they're still children. And
right.
So, what me and my staff may say for a 2-hour period, they may get in the car, somebody else says something different.
Yep.
7 to 10 different people say things different, social media wise, an uncle. And so you are really trying to create, to make them understand what a basketball team really means and what you have to sacrifice. I've told kids, if you don't want to be a teammate, then you need to swim or run cross country. You need to do an individual sport.
I tell them to take up curling.
Yeah.
Take up curling. If you really want a bowling or something like that, come on, take up something that, yes.
So yeah, just that teammate, because kids are so used to bouncing around AU-wise. They may play for six different teams. They'll transfer multiple times.
Right.
So nobody is really a good teammate. It's not like when I played, we ate lunch together, we hung out after school. Everybody is kind of individualized now, and I think that's really
– And I think as coaches, we got to help them with that a little bit. Because we always say we want them to be leaders and do things that leaders do, but I think we have to tell them what that is.
Like, right.
I always push my leader. Now, look, my son was one of my leaders this year and his friend. So it would be like, hey, let's do a team lunch on game days. Do these kind of things. Right. You know, all they need is a little bit of a prod, and then it's like, oh, that makes sense. That'll be fun. Right. You know, what about an actual basketball skill that you think's hard?
A basketball skill that is hard, passing.
Teaching passing. Like passing drills don't work. Like, I have not found the perfect passing drill yet.
And passing in the post is a lost art because the game has become spread. And so when you do, we had a 6'7". We had a real couple good 6'4 post guys. And our post entries at the beginning of the season were terrible. And we focused in. And as I just listened to college basketball and other high school coaches, everybody complained about entry passes. However, we don't have a traditional center anymore or that power forward. And if they're in AAU, it's spread out, it's pick and pop. So they really, truly don't know how to pass.
All that G League, NBA. It's all the screen, how you're reading screens. And
right.
Which is fine. That's the way the game has moved. Here's what I'll tell you. One thing I do that my college coach told me is he would only let us bounce pass to the post. He would not let us pass straight into the post.
Okay. Which
is an interesting concept. We don't tend to turn it over as much when we have to bounce pass it in. But it is a lost skill. When I ask this question, I think one of the harder things to teach is actually setting good screens. The footwork with that and the footwork with the reads off it is, you and I don't have time to teach all that.
No.
Just because we don't have the time with them. But you just watch that footwork stuff. It's so hard, so conceptual.
So when my bigs finally get set to set a good screen, the guards have gone too fast.
Yeah, or they've got they're halfway to the basket already when they get there to get set. Yes.
Right. So I think it's a combination, and if those programs who the young, if they're learning that third, fourth, and fifth, that will help the high school coach, and because you're just repetition, but. We struggle with that as well, setting the screens and getting wide and understanding shoulder to shoulder.
It's so hard. It's like, oh, my God. I think you could take a month on just teaching him that.
Absolutely.
So could you think of one coaching moment that we could dive into that might help somebody that's listening? Something that happened here could be a good thing, could be a bad thing. Just one, a story, something that maybe a coaching, something that one coaching moment that we could dive into that the audience might find interesting or might learn something from?
So as a young coach, I was an assistant coach for my dad, me and my brother. So me and all my brothers played college ball. We all played for my dad. And a lot of times we argued on the bench because we all had different visions of what we wanted. Okay. So, but at the end, it was all for the betterment of the team. But what I learned in that is, you don't always have to agree with the head coach, but at the end of the day, it's his final call. And whatever he calls, we have to live with.
Yep.
And I may not agree with it. And it doesn't – you don't go and talk to somebody, well, he made this bad decision. At that moment, we all have different visions, even my staff. But at the end of the day, I have to make that final call, because if we win, it's the kids. If we lose, it's me.
Right.
But as a staff, we have to come to – and understanding that there is going to be decisions that I make that they may not understand because I'm going with the Florida game.
Right.
And so staffers, they're all not going to always agree. The crowd doesn't always agree. You just have to live with that as a coach.
Right. And I think as you and I get older, as we get older in the coaching profession, I want as much input. I mean, I literally ask everyone, what do you think? What do you think?
Absolutely.
Because I know I'm going to make the decision at the end. I have no false sense of the buck stops with me. So I think for young coaches, there's a sense of insecurity a little bit when all this input's coming in. No, you should do this. You should do this. Well, you should want input. But then you're the key to a good leader is you got to take all that information and decipher it and then make the final decision.
And that decision is done in usually in a timeout from a 10 to 15 second span at most.
Right.
That we have to make that decision. But ultimately, like I say, I know my assistant coaches don't always agree with everything, and I can live with that. But at the end of the day, as long as we're on the same page and have the same common goal, I'm okay with that.
Perfect.
Hey, Coach, I'm glad you enjoyed that video. Let me know how I can help you become a better basketball coach. TeachHoops.com is one way that I can do that. I have coached every level, won lots of championships, lots of rings. Let me know how I can help you become a better basketball coach on and off the court. So check out TeachHoops.com for that.